Okay, I pushed the record button. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 399 and a half. There's a reason for that. We'll get to that at the end. Today's episode is called CQ Field Day from Whiskey Alpha 6, Papa, WA6P. That was our call sign for Field Day this year. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and I'm here to talk to you about Field Day. It's July 1st. We finished Field Day up about a week ago. It was a lot of fun, and I've got a bunch of video and some pictures, and I also have my sidekick here. Say hi, Gwen.
Hi, Gwen.
How's it going?
Pretty good. I'm tired.
You're tired? It's not from Field Day, though, right?
No.
Yeah, good, good. So I want to just bring Gwen here, and we got a bunch of information about Field Day, and we have some video, and we just wanted to share our experience with you. Maybe get some comments back in the YouTube group and on the Facebook page where we post this eventually on what you did and how it went for Field Day, and maybe give us some ideas on how to make it better or not.
Yes.
So what is Field Day? Do you know what Field Day is, Gwen?
It's when a bunch of like amateur radio people go out and they like try talking to everyone else.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So the Field Day is an organized event. It's not a contest, even though you turn in logs. And about 40,000 amateurs across the United States and Canada get together and they go out into the field, hence the name Field Day, to operate in simulated emergency situations to see how many contacts they can make far and wide, record them, and turn them in. And that's basically what Field Day is. You know, ideally, if you're doing it the way I think they want you to do it, you go out and set up somewhere that would be a place you'd set up if there was an emergency. You'd set up on non-grid based power, so generators or batteries or solar power or whatever else you can rig up to power your rigs. And you would operate for 24 hours simulating some kind of emergency. So how many field days have you done over the years?
A lot.
You have any idea? I think
like maybe four.
You've been four. I think this was my seventh, maybe eighth field day. It was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed doing it. We missed a couple here or there, or there was a couple years where we didn't hold one with our group, but I still went out and visited other groups for shorter periods of time. But I really enjoy these field days where we go and set up ahead of time and we stay pretty much the entire time, all of the 24 plus hours. And operate as much and long as we can. So this year we were WA6P. We used my friend Dean's call sign. He was there the whole time. And he's got a good call. And I think I want to talk about that in a little bit too, about call signs for Field Day, because that was something that perplexed me a little bit. I get why we'd do a short call. I'm not so sure what makes a short call better than another short call or anything like that. But we'll talk about that. And we set up in a different location that we have set up in the past, and it definitely provided some challenges, and I think some opportunities too. I think we learned a lot, like don't set up under electrical lines. There was a lot of noise from those, and I think that affected some of the contacts that we could have made. I think I learned we needed to pack sandwiches and more snacks. But I think otherwise, it was a good field day. We have some fun and excitement. I want to share some stuff with you, and I will apologize in advance for our podcast only listeners, because a lot of the stuff I'm going to show today is going to be video or picture based, and that will detract from the experience. So this will probably be a one or a two on the video scale, but it's what it is. So, that's not the right one. That's not the right one. Where's my screen? It's that NEC one. There we go. So, this year we operated from a new and different location, and that new and different location was a place called San Vicente Mountain Park. In the 1950s and 60s, it was known as LA-96C Charlie, the Nike radar control site, as you can see on the screen here if you're watching along. And this was kind of a remnant from the Cold War. there was on the top of this mountain, and you can see some of these pictures here, a ground-based tracking radar system that was designed to detect incoming hostile aircraft. And it was tied to a Nike missile battery that was in the valley floor a couple miles away, and they could shoot off those missiles and, I guess, take down some aircraft or other hostile forces that were coming in. You know, I did some research, and apparently there were a number of these across the Los Angeles area and all across the country. Found some old videos. This is a nice location. It overlooks the San Fernando Valley and the city of Los Angeles, high up atop a hillside. They've maintained some of the historical structures that are in that location, including this platform that they used to use with tracking radars. There's some other underground stuff. The city of Los Angeles has some antennas up there that they used for first responders, I think fire, police, and otherwise. There's a couple underground bunkers that are all covered up there, as well as the remnants of some barracks and other buildings that were used to support the site. There's some nice maps up there if you go walk up to the site, and some historical information as well. I did find some other information. This is from the Military Standard website, which shows you some information. The site was initially activated in 1957 and was deactivated in September 1974. I was about 7 years old then. And they tell you here that the Army National Guard still uses this for communications. And we actually have gone up there, you and me, Gwen, with the Army National Guard for some communication drills over the past few years. It was tied to this other site that I'll show you now, which was the actual launch battery, and that was on the valley floor near the Sepulveda Dam Basin. And you can see in the pictures there, there's these cutouts, and that literally was where the missiles were held in the ground on little elevator things, and if they needed to deploy them, they would deploy them up, and they could shoot them off. According to the historical information, apparently some of them even included nuclear tip missiles at some point along the way. A lot of other good information. If you wanted to search it up, you could Google Nike missile LA-96. In addition to that, you can go on this Military Standard site. They have lists of all these other sites from all across the United States. Where did it go? Anyways, there we go. You can see there were dozens and dozens of these from Hawaii, Florida, Texas, Alaska, New Mexico, Idaho, Washington. I think there was one I saw. There's some number of them in California. And I believe there were some on the East Coast as well. Again, it was all Cold War protection stuff. So back to our field day site. I'll share with you some pictures that we took when we first got up there. Here's a picture of one of our operators, Darren AJ6BL. And you can see that it was completely fogged in. And this was early in the setup time. We got there about 6 o'clock in the morning, maybe 6:30,
yeah,
something like that. And we pulled up, and you really couldn't see very far. It was hard to tell that we were on the top of the mountain. And it was kind of wet and damp. And we proceeded to get our stuff out and set some stuff up. We had tables and easy ups. We had a couple of mobile homes that were provided by our volunteers. We had our communication trailer out there as well. There's my FJ with all the equipment in it. And we had borrowed some, these are push-up towers from the one of the resources my friends have. Here's our emergency communications trailer. This is a couple of the guys setting up a 6-meter beam. And that was actually pretty successful. We had a lot of contacts on that. Here we're pounding some stakes in the ground in case it got windy to hold the easy ups down. We lost a lot of easy ups over the years, so we've started to stake them in the ground. And that's some serious rebar stakes there. There's Gwen and myself setting up the GOTA station. GOTA is Get On The Air. That's for us to do some communication with the public. It allows us to talk about field day with folks that just kind of happen to wander by, and gives us an opportunity to invite them to come and join us on the air and actually put civilians that don't have radio licenses and allow them to participate in field day. And we did have a number of folks, including some kids. I'll show you some video and a little bit of it. Here we continue to set up, and you know, we do the best to make it clean and nice and easy for us to operate. We put tarps down, we got tables, there's lots of equipment that's needed to put together field day, so we try to keep the stuff clean and reduces the dirt in the rigs, as it were. There's Darren and David. I think that's at the GOTA station. Darren's a new ham, even though he's extra, so he has the ability to work the GOTA station for a certain number of points. And you can see the fog's starting to lift a little bit. This is a little later in the morning. Dean and Houston are there working on Dean's new ICOM 7610. And I'm setting up camera there to record some video. Oh, and there's some of our visitors at the GOTA station. In fact, it's probably a good time. I'll play some video here.
Okay, very good. So here's what you're going to say. CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day from Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha. Can you say that?
CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day from Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha.
That's almost good, but it's Kilo Kilo 6
Delta Alpha.
That's the abbreviation for KK60A. Okay, and you could just say KK60A. Okay, very good. Are you ready? Press the microphone when you're ready and say this.
Do I hold it down?
Yeah, you hold it and hold it right about here.
Do you, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day from Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha. Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha. Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha. KK60A Field Day.
Okay, let's see if someone comes back. Well, you know, it's a winner. Very good. Try it once again. Say the same thing once again.
CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day from Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha, Kilo Kilo 6 Delta Alpha, KK60A Field Day.
KM6WWI,
KM6GXS. Was it GMX?
GXX, I think.
KM6GSS?
X-ray, X-ray. Or SS.
So that's some of the videos we took. Gwen got to work the real rigs, not the GOTA station, right?
Yeah.
Which ones did you work?
I think I worked 6 meter, and I did a little bit of the other one in the trailer.
The 20 meters?
Yeah.
Yeah. Make a lot of contacts?
I don't know if it was a lot, but it was like a good amount.
Yeah. How long do you think you worked for?
I don't know.
You don't know. So we were 2 alpha. And with the 2 alpha, we had 2 HF rigs. Plus you get a bonus UHF VHF rig, which we had running 6 meters. And we also had 2 meters and 70 centimeters, as well as having a 220 on there. And I know there was some period in the middle of the night when I got up where I worked a whole bunch of stations just working through the calling frequencies on UHF, VHF. And that was kind of fun. And it was all the same people, but everybody was switching around to try to make contacts. Let's look at a little more of the shots and stuff we have. There's
you need
another
to put it onto the screen.
Oh, yeah, good point. Which one did we decide
NEC.
It was?
NEC. No.
The NEC one. There we go. Oh yeah, here's a little more of the video. This one's short. No, that's that same contact. No, that was it for that. Then they work a little bit more here. Let's see who else we had. Oh, and I think at some point, the younger brother stepped in. He did a little bit, as well as we got Dad in there. Let's see what Dad did. Definitely a lot of traffic there on the UHF, VHF frequencies. Oh, look here. Even I got to sit in a chair. So this was the 6-meter rig.
Yep.
And I will, it's about a minute worth of video. I guess it's worth playing. Let's see me operating.
Field day, CQ field day, whiskey alpha 6, papa, CQ field day.
Wow.
CQ field day, CQ field day, whiskey alpha 6, papa, CQ field day. Whiskey alpha 6, papa. N6KNW, you are what, LAX? Copy, N6KNW, you're 1 Delta LAX, we are 2 Alpha Lima Alpha X-ray, 2 Alpha LAX. Doing well, where are you at?
That's a good sign.
Oh, he left.
Okay.
Miguel, getting ready for the
CQ.
Oh, that was that contact. I think there's a little bit more.
Day, whiskey alpha 6, papa. WA6 IRC, whiskey alpha 6, papa is 2 alpha, Lima alpha X-ray. What is your identifier? Okay, we copy 2 Alpha SJD, 2 Alpha Sierra Juliet Delta. Thanks for the contact.
Okay, in the old show, in the old days, this would be about the part where Gary would stop the show and say, what's a good field day contact sound like? Because that was not a good field day contact. I mean, I did make it work, and it was definitely a valid field day contact, but there's a lot more I think I was saying than I'm supposed to say. And I don't remember if anybody taught you about what it's supposed to be, but I think, you know, you're supposed to call CQ field day and then have somebody respond back to you and respond back to them, and then you give them your exchange, not identifier. And my brain farted at that time. I couldn't remember what the word was for it. And I think the whole niceties at the end where you say, oh, you know, thanks or have a great field day or whatever is probably not good etiquette for the real contesters. But field day is not really a real contest, so I'm not really sure. I wonder what y'all think out there. Should we be nice and exchange information? Did you do that when you made your contacts, Gwen?
Usually people would do it to me, and then I'd be like, oh yeah, like you too. I wouldn't like actively do it.
Yeah. But when they said stuff to you, you'd reply back to them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The nice thing about the location this year was we were on a fire trail that's very heavily populated. It's a good spot for hikers and bikers and folks that are out getting their morning exercise. Actually, kind of all day long. Yeah, walking their dog. And kind of all day long. I think there was even one motorcycle that came through while we were there. And a lot of folks stopped and asked what was going on. We had a couple of bikers that went by and cheered, you know, something about, oh, field day. They knew exactly what it was. And some of them stopped. A lot of them stopped. People wanted to know if the world was ending or if everything was okay or what we were doing. And I don't think I had anybody Oh, except the one guy on the bicycle that rode over the cone. I don't think anybody was negative about it. Did anybody negative with you about what we were doing there or why? Or
Nope.
And I think that was good. It was a good positive image about amateur radio. And it gave us an opportunity to talk to the public and actually invite them to come and operate a rig. But at least tell them about what field day was. And I think it was funny over time I'd listen to how different people would describe what was happening, and every once in a while I would kind of join into the conversation because some folks understood what it was and some folks kind of said, you know, we're doing amateur radio, but you got to tell more about that. And that was really good. I really enjoyed that. Let's see what else we got video wise. I know there's some video you took. So that's overlooking north west from where we are. There's a reservoir and then the San Fernando Valley. And there's our generators. And you can see on the ground there our grounding rod. We put the generators on the table because it's dirty there, and they're strapped on. We primarily used one at a time, but we had the backups just in case. And you can see the coffee pot there. Sadly, by the end of field day, I broke that coffee pot.
Yeah. You put it on the table with the generators, it slowly wiggled itself off.
Yeah, the generators make there's a lot of action on that table, a lot of bouncing around. There's Darren taking a picture of himself in the valley and the reservoir below. I'm not sure what this picture was. It's a bush. That's looking south. That's from up on the hill where the bathrooms were, looking over our setup. See some of the wire antennas. We were pretty much, except for that 6 meter beam, well, we were exclusively using wire antennas. I had a 40 and a 20 meter dipole, and we had a alpha delta antenna that was a ladder dipole, and it worked okay, but not awesome. We also weren't able to get it more than about 30 feet off the ground. There's a panoramic shot from up at the top of the tracking station. They have some binoculars up there, and there's the platform that you can go walk up and see. And there's a panorama shot from where we were, all the cars parked. And another one. There's Dean, and he's they're setting up for our one failed satellite attempt. We were not able to make an exchange. We heard the bird, but we weren't able to talk to him, sadly. We tried. There was only one really good pass that we saw during the day working. I think it was SO50, but we weren't able to make the contact. And by the time we tried, it was kind of late, and there weren't any other good passes, I think, other than like stupid o'clock in the morning, and most of us took a couple hours off to sleep. And actually, I have some video of that.
All right.
Yeah, we should see it now, dude. It's still low on the horizon. It's when it gets, it gets like that, you'll start to hear something. If it's going to work.
When it starts to work.
When it works. I hear something.
It's an aero antenna with a mini iPad mounted on the end with a satellite tracking app. It actually shows you where it is on the horizon, so you can kind of point towards it. It was fun. My arms got tired after a while, but it was fun. I mean, Gwen's behind me with the video camera.
No talking, please.
The thing about the way the satellites work is depending on how their antennas are pointed, you've got to rotate your antenna so that you get the right polarization to be able to hear it. And you got to remember, it's, you know, hundreds of miles above, and we're only transmitting at pretty low power, you know, 5 watts or so, trying to make that contact.
Oh.
This should be the beacon.
Do you see it?
We should hear a CW beacon.
Yeah, and Gwen zoomed in to see if she could see the satellite, but that wasn't happening.
I think that white in the sky.
Yeah, I think it was a plane. Yeah, that's the plane. And we had a helicopter almost land on us at one point.
Gwen.
Yeah.
The part that you need to get the video of is you need to be able to hear Dean's audio. So, do this.
The mic?
Take the mic, put the mic next to Dean.
Okay.
Take the mic and the mic stand, put it next to Dean. Put the camera over there, point it towards me.
Famous last words.
I hear the beacon.
Yeah, me too.
So wave it around and see if you...
So, audio's hard. Audio's really hard. So when you plug the remote microphone into the camera... You have to remember to turn the microphone on.
Well, you didn't tell me that part.
Yeah, sorry. At some point, we figured that out, I guess, because it got turned on.
I didn't.
And then maybe it got turned off again. I think there's some, if we go up further. No, some close-up of my needing to shave. Yep. And there's the microphone in the picture with the sound turned off. Let's see. Here's a good segue here. Field day points. So it's not a contest, right, Gwen?
It's not a contest.
Yeah, it's not a contest. They're not looking at you. So Gwen, you did the
it's not a contest.
But we keep points. There's points for things, but it's not a contest. So one of the things you can get points for, actually there's a lot of things you can get points for, having a safety officer. That was me. Got 100 points for me, and I had to fill out a whole list of things that we did, and we had a grounding rod, and we put safety tape up on the antennas, and we had these cones, and we made sure nobody electrocuted themselves, and I'm trained in first aid, and we had hard hats and all those things. There's other points that you can get for things like making the satellite contact, right? We tried really hard. It's 100 points. And 100 points, if you think about voice contacts, it's a point per voice contact. So that's like 100 voice contacts. That would have been awesome if we had done that. It's 50 CW contacts or 50 digital contacts, but we didn't do that. So we missed out on those 100 points. We did get the safety officer points. There were points for having a served agency visit you. And sadly on my phone, but not here. I had a picture of the gentleman from the Mountain Recreation Center, one of their rangers, come up and visit us. And we work with them at this location when we work with the National Guards. And we use some of their other locations as well. And we do service projects for them with the Boy Scouts. So they're considered a served agency for us. So we got 100 points for his visit. We also get 100 points for having an elected official come. And why would you want to have why do you think you'd want to have an elected official come join us?
To like spread the ham radio to like people, like to like inform them about it.
Yeah, that's good. He said too many likes, but absolutely. Yeah, it's basically you want your elected officials to know all the great volunteer work that we did. And we were able to have our councilman, Bob Blumenfeld, come out and visit us. And I took some video of it.
You have to put it on the screen.
I have to put it on that screen. And here it is.
So these are HF stations. And everyone, this is the Councilman from Womanfield.
Hi, I'm Dean Calandra. Hi, Dean.
Good morning.
Houston, nice to meet you.
Can you bring up the log and show us the contacts you made? So these.
this is kind of a quick at a glance of where we've gotten. So, you know, we've been as far north as Manitoba, Canada. We have, if you go east, Kentucky and Tennessee.
If you map, you can pull up a map. If you map, so that I'll fill it in a second. It's all the colored states and provinces of Canada, those ones I'm talking
about. The band conditions have not been super favorable this weekend, but we're usually do better than that. So anything that's colored, we've been able to talk to. As you know, in a disaster, getting out of state, out of area communication is very important. And that's one of the reasons for this exercise. We're operating on
40 meters.
So 40 meters in CW, there's more stuff. We're going to operate on the voice also. So we're doing this. Yeah, absolutely.
The thing about Morse code is it cuts through the noise and junk of, like, nobody's business. You can get a message through with CW that on a phone you just can't.
Rusty at my Morse code.
It's fun when it, when you get it back. It's like, oh, I remember this. This is fun.
So we're going to be tuned on.
Yeah, I just talked to Jamie about it.
Now you don't even need Morse code.
You don't need Morse code, you don't.
When I got my license when I was 9, when you needed Morse code.
You know, it's a fortunate thing that they've got rid of the jobs. When you meet people into the hobby that wouldn't normally get it. Now, the bad thing is, it's becoming a loss.
Hi.
Good
morning.
Good.
How
are you doing?
Good.
You
good? What's going on?
This is called Field Day, and it's a nationwide emergency communications exercise. And we're just practicing our capabilities of reaching other areas in case of a disaster.
Oh, cool. Well, good to see that you're out. Mm-hmm. You know.
Well, thank you.
When something happens, you're ready.
We're working on it. We're trying.
Cool.
Have a safe ride.
Thanks.
So it's a loss. But there are other ways nowadays, receiving CW and sending CW. The RV coders are actually.
There's probably an app for that, right?
Exactly. There's apps for that. You can send it to your keyboard.
So that was great. So that was Councilman Blumenfeld, and he was a ham. He got licensed when he was 9 years old. He's let it lapse since then. But he's been talking about getting it back. And he also heard in that exchange, somebody rode up on a bicycle and asked what was going on. And that's kind of how it went pretty much all day while it was light out. People would ride up and turn the mic off before you move it. There you go. People would ride up and come and say hello. And that was how it went. It was pretty positive. People wanted to know what was going on. And once they heard what it was, everybody was all very happy and wanted to wish us good luck. A couple people actually got cards and wanted to come and take a class over time. So I think it was a good thing. You checking to see if you're turned on there?
I don't know.
There's a switch on the front here. Yeah, now it's off. So that was Councilman Blumenfeld and what he talked about. And I'll show you another video. So this was in the morning, and this is just right after Councilman Blumenfeld walked away. And you can see the fog bank rolled in again. It got really dark. And that's kind of how it was when we woke up in the morning. But by the afternoon, it burned off, and it made it kind of wet. And all the easy apps were covered. All the cars were wet and covered as well. Here's a quick, great, short shot of the sun going down. This was Saturday night. Things are kind of progressing along. And I think this was Gwen took a walk around our site. You can see there KK60A, he was running the GOTA station. He brought along these dual Yagis for 440 and 2 meters, 70 centimeters and 2 meters. And this is our GOTA station running off his Yaesu FT991A. That's David, KK60A. He did a great job with GOTA this year. You can see all of our towers and coax. This was our main HF station here. That was the ICOM 7610, brand new radio. Literally came out of the box for the first time at field day. Yeah, you have some pictures. Yeah. We did an unboxing at field day. There's our trailer, and you can see the sunset there in the background. And in there was the UHF VHF and the second HF station. I guess everybody was on a break now. This was probably shortly after dinner.
No, it's not me. I'm off now. You still hear me? Are you sure it's me?
Yeah, we had an issue on the... We had a little issue on our 6-meter rig. The push-to-talk got locked on the transmitter, and we had the open mic for a little while. There's my military mast antenna, push-up antenna set. We had a dipole going on there. Yeah, I had to get some pictures of the beautiful sunset. Oh, yeah. So here, I think... let's see. Somewhere in one of these videos... Oh, that's the dirty lens. Okay, I wanted to pull up another video. Bear with me for a moment here. We got some great videos of different things. And here, we talked about points. So one of the things you can do is W1AW on the West Coast transmits a message, and they transmit it CW, RTTY, and you know, the digital modes as well. And this was the first year we used FL Digi to copy the message from headquarters, as it were.
That's a split infinitive to quickly push. That's terrible.
Yes, it is. Maybe doubly split.
It was a really strong signal and really clear, so they got a good copy of that message. And you can see the sun's out bright. That was late in the afternoon.
Oh, I dropped a letter. I wonder if they dropped
it. Ham radio.
So that shows even you non-CW operators for your next year in field day, you figure out how to make FL Digi interface with your rig, or even just open the mic and open the speaker on your laptop. You can actually capture those bulletins and decode them. Let's see, I think we covered all those videos. So the thing I really wanted to get to was I wanted to talk about call signs on field day. We had a whole debate at our field day site about call signs and what would be a good call sign. And I wondered to myself, what would be a good call sign? I thought from both a CW perspective and just for calling voice, probably the shorter ones were better. And hence we used Dean's call sign, WA6P. I mean, he's an extra class, and he's got that shortest call sign possible without having a special event station call sign, of course. And there was some debate back and forth. There were some folks that were concerned of having WA6P, that stations were going to be looking for another letter after the fact. In fact, I actually did have that on one of the HF stations when I was working late at night and the conditions were just fair. I kept having people come back with WA6PP because you'd say Whiskey Alpha 6 Papa, and they would think that I was saying Papa twice. And we had some other extra class 4-digit calls. Ruzi W1EH, he's there the whole time, but it's not a 6-land call, and folks were concerned about not having a 6-land call. I always think of that as being a bonus. You're going to drive folks to it.
We've also used K6MA.
Yeah, Terry Hall, K6MA. He wasn't able to be there this year. We use his call sign when they're there. I think that's the rule. They've got to be on the premises for the duration of the event. And that was a good one, K6MA. And that one kind of follows the standard that folks want us to use, thinking that people aren't going to think there's extra letters at the end. But I still can imagine somebody would think that there'd be one more after MA. You know, a lot of calls, like my call, has 3 letters after that. But I don't know. Wonder what folks out there think, what the comments on that is. I heard a lot of stations operating all weekend long that had 6-letter calls from all across the country. People that hadn't upgraded their calls from whatever they got when they were initially got their tech license. And I have upgraded mine, and Gwen upgraded hers. But I heard a lot of those calls. Some of them are hard to hear. Some of them aren't. But, you know, you get used to the phonetics. And as long as you use the I2U phonetics, I think it makes it easy enough to pull out.
Yeah. But there are some people that weren't using, like, Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, like, the whole, like, list. And it was kind of like my brain hurt. Like, I had to, like, think about which letter they were saying because they weren't using the actual I2U phonetics.
Do you remember any of those?
Like, radio, or, like, they were using, like, countries. And it was like, just use the list.
Right. Radio, Japan, America.
That's Canada.
There's some local guys here that you hear them every day on field day. Radio, Japan, America. And I guess after a while you get used to those, and the countries are easy enough. But yeah, use the ITO phonetics, please, folks. It makes it a lot easier to copy.
Yeah.
What are the other things that we get points for? We get points for safety, the messages that we did, the satellite contacts. Oh, doing an educational class. So if you have some kind of organized educational experience, you get 100 points for putting on a class. And in the past, our friend NA6MA Mort, who's now Silent Key and had actually donated one of those rigs that we used for field day that we used in the trailer, he used to put on either an RF class or a soldering class. One year they did something on power poles. And this year Darren, who's a guy that took a lot of the video for me, he brought along a field RF meter. He used to be a roadie and he does sound and video stuff as a profession. I don't exactly know what it is. I apologize. And he brought along a great little meter, and it showed the RF from those power lines that were right over us. And it was like 3/4 pegged on the meter when you stood right underneath them. And as you went across the street or across the dirt road where we were, it was much less. And that's why we set our antennas up there. So he taught several of us about how to use that meter and how it worked and what kind of what you're looking for. Can't really think of any other things we got points for or we were looking for points for. Oh, radiograms. You get points for sending your section manager a radiogram, and then you can get an additional 10 points for sending an additional, maybe it's 100 points, 10 points per radiogram. I'll have to look at the rules. You get additional points for sending out 10 additional radiograms from your site. And we did that. You want to tell them about sending radiograms, learning from your friend Clara?
So Clara had like kind of like a script that you like I could just like copy down like most of it. And then I don't remember if she told me what to say or you told me what to say. And then I wrote like in each one of the blanks.
Yeah, I wrote
each word.
I think I told you what to say for the script.
And then there was another script that was just like for the 10 other people, which was just like friends that had ham radio licenses and that kind of stuff. And they were all like, we had like one script for that one. And then it was just like we filled in the contact, like the sending information.
Yeah, it was like we sent one message to those 10 random hams, and they were all friends of mine, including I sent one to Gary, I sent one to Dan Romanchak, I sent one to a number of the Boy Scout folks that have ham radio license. And basically it was, you know, something to the effect of greetings from field day. And I told them where we were doing it and that we were having lots of fun and wish you were here. The one we sent to Diana, who's our section manager, again, went something like, we're here, this is this group, and we've had X number of members of the Aries team, and then how many visitors. And I was thinking about the visitors later on. We logged the folks that like actually came and sat at the GOTA station. But if we had really thought about it, we should have counted every person that rode
inquired.
By. Yeah, everybody that rode by and said hello, we would have probably had over 100 on Saturday, and maybe another 25 or 30 on Sunday by the time we closed up. I think that's all the point stuff we did. And then there's the ever-important food at field day. And I think this was a fail for me this year. In the past, we've done barbecues, but because we were in the mountains in a wilderness type area, they didn't want us to do any cooking or barbecue or any of those kinds of things. Excuse me. So we didn't. We brought some snacks along, and we did get breakfast beforehand. I was good about that. And I was hoping at some point there'd be a break for lunch, but I don't think we got to break for lunch until it was actually dinner time.
No.
And then we made an El Pollo Loco run. I think the food was good. Yeah. It was good enough.
It was food.
It was food. And by the time we got it, we were all hungry, and that was good. And everybody sat down, took a little break, and had dinner. I do kind of miss when we used to do it at the local college. A number of years, we did put together a big barbecue, kind of a fundraiser thing. We did tri-tip and chicken, and I think we had like 60 people show up one year, and that was really good. It was just nice to have the whole amateur radio team together and gave people opportunity to come by, and gave the folks that were operating all day a chance to break for dinner, and other folks sat in the seat and ran the radios then. We hope to get back to that or figure out some other ways to do better meals in the future. That El Pollo wasn't bad, but could have used some more food throughout the day. And then somebody was nice enough to bring donuts in the morning. Somebody that was there in the afternoon before and didn't want to spend the night, but came back in the morning to help us clean up field day, which is, it's always a big challenge setting up and breaking everything down. But we did have a number of folks there to help, and it actually went fast. I think we were cleaned up within an hour. We ran the radios right up until 11 o'clock.
Well, some of them.
We closed up a couple of them. That's
like
true.
10.
Well, we were running that main HF rig right up until 11 o'clock. And then I think we were cleaned up and closed down in about an hour. It was good. So food at your field day site, that's got to be important. And I know I've seen videos from other sites where they put on big barbecues and they do the whole nine yards. And we had coffee, hot coffee, until I broke the coffee pot. But that wasn't until the morning. And then we had some snacks. You know, we made a CVS run and had some chips and nuts and M&Ms and stuff like that. And I know somebody brought the brownies, and there were cookies and what have you. We'd probably do a better job with that next year. Wasn't sure what we were going to encounter up there.
Yeah.
And nobody worked all night long at our field day site. I think because the major part of our team, the setup, kind of the hardcore field dayers, you know, me and Gwen and Dean, Dean's friend Houston, who was new but was a great addition, Ruzi, David A, KK60A, and Darren were the kind of the hardcore guys. And we all showed up at 6 in the morning pretty much, and we pretty much stayed all night and until about noon the next day after we were done cleaning up. There were a number of other guys that came and joined us on and off. Art, and I don't remember Art's call sign exactly. Art came later in the afternoon, but he did stay all night and stayed to clean up, and that was awesome. Scott was up there early in the morning to help set up, and then he came back with the donuts and to help us clean up and break down. A bunch of other guys, too. I've forgot some of the names, some of the folks that were there. But we had a good group. Clara, KJ6CNO, was up there, and she did a really great little impromptu class for Gwen on how the radiogram form works, and gave Gwen an opportunity to write up those radiograms. And you even sent most of them.
Yeah, I sent about half of them.
Yeah. Sent them off to the NTS liaison that was offsite. And no major problems. Nobody got hurt. I did pinch my hand. I'm recovering slowly off of one of those antennas. Towers, as they were getting put together or taken apart or something, that hurt a little bit. But I don't think there was any other first aid stuff anybody had to do. And I was a safety officer, and of course, I was the one with the injury. That's been the case in the past before. WA6VHA was the only one that took a fall the year he was a safety officer. But it was a good time. What else? Anything else do you think we didn't talk about? What was good at field day? Yeah. I did come away with some lessons. I actually started a log, a list of the things that I need to do. So for the future field days, better food.
The antenna setup was kind of messed up. But
yeah, so
it
what
got
was,
fixed.
What do you mean?
I don't know. Like, I don't really understand all that stuff, but I just like... No, everyone had like issues.
Yeah. So let's talk about that a little bit. In the past years, we've had temporary towers that we stake into the ground, and we put up a real beam. And where we were located, because it was kind of on a top of a ridge with a narrow fire road, and we had to leave space for a fire truck to get through if it needed to, and there were people on bikes coming through all on and off all day, we decided that putting up a full, we have a tri-band beam that the Ares group owns, and it's 20 by 20, I think, would probably have been a problem to put that. It's a 15, 20, 40 meter, I think, something like that, would have been a problem to put up. And so we didn't do it. So we put up wire antennas, and you know, those wire antennas are okay. The fan dipole we put up, everybody thought was going to be awesome, and it wasn't really great. It seemed like a compromise antenna for me. It had a lot of noise. It was hard to get tuned down. And maybe we didn't have it high up in the air. I did bring along a 20 meter and a 40 meter dipole, and we made most of the contacts on those. It was a little challenging because when we wanted to switch radios out, it was just easier to switch operators from one radio to the other radio as opposed to moving the coax from one to the other. And the RF noise from those electrical lines probably played a big part. There was also, if you can see, let's see if I can pull this up on one of the pictures. You can see on the pictures I took. Let's see. I'll put it over there. There was one other problem we had, which was a dirt filter. We had one big dirt filter. Let's see. I don't know if there's a good picture in this. So you can see this direction. That was really great. That was a really great open direction. And we're on the West Coast, and that's pretty much facing west. So it was only good for us for Hawaii. On the other side, you know, that's not down there. You can kind of see here. On the right-hand side of the screen, I'm kind of circling with my mouse.
Your
I guess
mouse
you can't see it.
Showing.
Yeah, mouse doesn't show up. But if you look on the right side, where that telephone pole is, that was due east. And so that caused us some challenges. I think that reduced some of our ability to make contacts. And that would be something that we'd like to fix in the next year. Actually, this one slide back, this shows actually up at the top of the hill. And that was facing east. That's a great angle. And we weren't sure we could go up that far. We talked to the ranger towards the end of Saturday night. And he said, oh, yeah, if you need to go up there, if you want to go up there, that was okay with him. That was real far away. It was at least 300, 400 feet from the high-tension electrical lines. And one telephone pole you can actually see in the picture isn't actually even working. There's no wires on it anymore. So next year we may try to set up there, and that might help improve our ability to talk. So I think that kind of covers what I want to talk about today. Our wrap up from field day, kind of a quick overview. Wanted to make sure you guys got some content. Wanted to talk about it. I hope in the Facebook group and on our YouTube page, I hope this stirs some comments, good, bad, or otherwise. I know we'll get the bad ones from a couple of folks that are in there all the time. But I'd like to know, you know, how your field day experience went, what worked good for you and what didn't work good for you. I think we can all learn from each other. That's, you know, to me, that's what amateur radio is all about, is, you know, teaching others about what they can do, make it better, make it worse. Well, I guess not make it worse, but, you know, what kind of challenges did you run into? And if you ran into a challenge, maybe somebody else knows how to fix it. And with that, I'll do my pitch. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. I don't have any sponsors other than you. So if you like what you're doing,
you can see him.
I can see him. He's right here. If you like what I'm doing, come visit hamradionow.tv. Find our chief financial officer, Arvin. He's sitting on the thing here. And click the pig and show some love. Help us out. I can't do it without you. I could, but it all comes out of my pocket. Don't have a ton of expenses, but hosting this and the feeds for the podcasts, there's some expenses in there. And ideally, over time, I'd like to get some new equipment in the studio to help make this better and better. So thanks for supporting me. Thanks to all the Patreons that are out there. Thanks for the occasional money in the PayPal account. We just appreciate it all. Again, I hope you enjoy what we're doing and you'll keep coming back. And with that, where are you? That's not you. Where's the Gwen cam? Oh, there's the Gwen cam. You are?
November 6th, Golf Mike Golf. Gwen Goldenberg.
Gwen Goldenberg, my co-host. And I am David Goldenberg, Whiskey Zero, Delta Hotel Golf. Saying thanks for tuning in to episode number 399 and a half. Oh, yeah, we're supposed to talk about that, too.
Oh, let's do it.
Let's do it. Mm-hmm. Should we do it after this close?
What do you mean?
You know, after we do the other thing and the flyby? We should do it now.
Yeah,
Let's do it now. 399 and a half. It's a goofy number for a podcast.
Yeah.
It is. So we reached this number, and, you know, this should have been a number 400 show. But I was really hoping to have number 400 show with Gary. And I had special surprise lined up. And they're off to Hawaii. And they have limited internet ability. And I really want to respect his time with Cindy. So not yet, but there will be a 400th episode in a week or two when Gary gets back, which means there might actually be a 399 and three quarters episode too. But yeah, that's how we ended up with this. And it's what it is. So, thanks for joining us. Ready to close this out?
Yeah.
This was Ham Radio Now. Over.
And out. Oh.
Did it work?
What's that?
That's the close thing.
Did it work?
I don't know. Ooh. I don't think it worked. I hate it when it doesn't work. Oh, well. Thanks for joining us.
Bye.